Good morning. It's great to see everyone this morning. Hope everybody's having a good start to their day, start to their week. Just got a couple of announcements this morning. James and Lee Thompson's sister, Corinne Belcher of Forest Park, Georgia, passed away Friday. The funeral will be Tuesday at the Forest Park Church of Christ in Forest Park, Georgia. So be sure to keep them in our prayers. Devlin is able to be here with us today. He's doing some better. My wife is not. She's at home with the baby. Both of them are not feeling real well. So, any other announcements or anything that I missed? If not, I'll turn this over to Clay.
First song this morning will be 891 in your songbooks. 891. We'll sing it twice. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Our song before prayer this morning will be 853. 853, we'll sing all four verses.
God is so good. Look to you for guidance and bring peace to this world.
Father, we know that there's a lot of unrest in our own country. We ask that you would bless the leaders as they make decisions that they can bring peace about in our country as well. Father, we also know that our president is sick with the coronavirus. We ask that you would touch him to the fullest extent your healing hand allows. Father, we ask that you would be with all the ones who are sick. We ask that you would bless them with your healing power. Father, we also know that there are those that have lost loved ones, and we ask that you would comfort them and help us to be there as a comfort for them as best we can. Father, we realize that there's a great need for a return to you in this world, and especially in this country. Father, this country was built on Christian principles, and that's why it was such a success and flourished. Father, we're struggling now, though, and the reason we're struggling is because we've turned our back on you, and we ask that you would be with us as a nation to wake up and realize the error of our ways before we lose the wonderful opportunities that we have in this country. Father, we ask that you would be with us as we go about our daily lives, that we may look for opportunities to share the good news with the people around us before it's too late. Father, we're so thankful for so many things that you do for us, but there's nothing more important than the sacrifice that your Son made that we may have hope for eternal life. Father, help us to live by the example that you set before us so that someday heaven can be our home. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Our next song this morning will be 784. 784. We'll sing all three verses.
Why did my Savior come to earth and to his precious life for me, for me.
Our song before the Lord's Supper this morning is 645. We'll sing the first and fourth verses. If you can please stand with me as we sing this song, prepare our mind.
On a hill far away,
casting lots, and sitting down, they began to keep watch over him there. And they put up above his head the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." At that time, two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who were passing by hurled abuse at him, wagged their heads, and said, "You who were going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God, let him deliver him now, if he takes pleasure in him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers also, who had been crucified with him, were casting the same insult at him. Now from the sixth hour of darkness fell upon the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" There are hardly any words that are more tragic than the words forsaken. To be abandoned, deserted, forsaken. But these are the words that the Word of God uses to describe the relationship that existed between the Father and the Son as He went to the cross, bearing our sin, bearing our shame. Let us give thanks for the redemption that we have through Jesus. Our God and our Father, we come before You this morning thanking You for the spiritual blessings that we have in Christ Jesus. We are thankful that the penalty of sin that we were all under has been paid for by Jesus, Your Son. We gather here today to worship You, to honor You, and to give You thanks that You were willing to allow Your Son, who had no sin, to become sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. We remember His body crucified for us as we eat the bread. In Jesus' name, amen. Our God and Father, we come before You again, mindful of the blood that was shed, remembering that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. As His lifeblood coursed out of His veins, as He said, "It is finished," we remember that the redemptive work for our salvation was completed on that old rugged cross. And again, we give You thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us give God thanks for our blessings. Our God and our Father, we know that every good and perfect gift comes from You. And there are many blessings that You give us that we fail to even recognize sometimes. Indeed, our blessings are plentiful. They are as the sand of the seashore. And we give You thanks today. We pray that You would forgive us when we fail to have the gratitude, when we fail to have the appreciation, when we fail to have the thankful heart that we ought to have. We have just remembered some of the spiritual blessings that we have in Christ Jesus. We know that we have material blessings. We know that we have the blessing of health. But Father, we don't just give You thanks for the blessings that we do have, but we give You thanks for the opportunities that we have. And we are mindful of those whose blessings are not as plentiful as ours. For those who have never heard of the spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus, we pray and ask that through our mission efforts that they will be reached. For those who do not enjoy the level of health that we do, we pray for their healing. For those who do not enjoy the bountiful blessings of the material wealth that we have, we pray, Father, that You would have compassionate hearts, that we, like Mary, would do what we can. But Father, at this time, we do give You thanks for every good and perfect gift, and acknowledge that they come from You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our next song this morning will be 220 in the Psalms. 220. I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Our song after the lesson this morning will be 421 in your songbooks if you'd like to mark it. Our song before the lesson will be 408. 408, if you can stand with me as we sing this song. We'll sing all three verses.
Lo, in the grave He lay, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave He arose with a mighty triumph o'er His foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and He lives forever with His saints to reign. He arose, He arose,
He arose,
hallelujah, Christ arose. Mainly they watched His bed, Jesus, my Savior. Vainly they sealed the dead, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave He arose with a mighty triumph o'er His foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and He lives forever with His saints to reign. He arose, He arose,
He arose,
hallelujah, Christ arose. Death cannot keep His prey, Jesus, my Savior. He tore the bars of
From the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose,
he arose.
Hallelujah, Christ arose.
I had something of an epiphany yesterday while I was driving down Sparta Pike. Now, in order to explain that epiphany to you, I've actually got to go all the way back to 1984. In the summer of 1984, my family moved from Clarksville, Tennessee to Nashville, Tennessee. That fall, I was going to start middle school at David Lipscomb Middle School in Nashville. Now, being the self-respecting boy from Clarksville, I showed up on Lipscomb's campus on the first day of school wearing blue jeans and my cowboy boots. And I learned two very important lessons that day. The first lesson that I learned was the meaning to Barbara Mandrell's song, "I Was Country When Country Wasn't Cool." The second lesson that I learned was the importance of conformity if you don't want to be ridiculed. So, for the next number of years, all I owned in my closet was khakis. Khakis and button-downs. Part of that had to do with conforming to school, not standards, but the culture there. The other part had to do with my mother, who required that all of us at Hot Shot Delivery wear khakis. Well, when I was hired at Corinth, I continued to wear the khakis, but now I realize I'm in a one-man office, and so if I want to wear my blue jeans and my Justin boots, then I'm going to do that. I'll still dress business casual if I have a meeting or something along those lines, but I just happen to like my blue jeans. Well, for a number of years now, my sister has been calling me country, and I have resisted that terminology. Not that there's anything wrong with that terminology, but I just didn't think that wearing blue jeans in and of itself made me quote-unquote country. Of course, bear in mind, my sister lives in Green Hills, so there is a little bit of a culture difference there. Alright, so now I have gotten us back to 1984. Let's fast forward to yesterday. I got up yesterday and I realized, or I didn't realize, I decided that there was this area of the yard that needed some extra mulch. So I throw on some blue jeans and a shirt, and I go to Lowe's, and I get the mulch, and I do the work that I wanted to do there. But I underestimated how much mulch that I needed, and so I decided I wasn't going to make another trip to Lowe's just for the two bags of mulch. I would just pick them up on my way home from church today. The problem with that is about the time I made that decision, my ADHD kicked in and the notion of an unfinished project got the best of me. So when I got home from Lowe's the first time, I changed clothes and I put on my overhauls because you can't get fatigues anymore in a post 9/11 world. And so I've had to transition to my overhauls. And I decided that I wasn't going to change clothes just to go to Lowe's to get two bags of mulch. So I'm driving down Sparta Pike on my way to Lowe's, and here's the epiphany. I was in my truck, Trig was in the front passenger seat, I look down and see that I'm wearing overhauls on my way to Lowe's, and it hit me, my sister might be right. One of my earliest memories of my grandfather on my father's side was him wearing overhauls, and he had his pipe tobacco in the bib pocket there. Made me think of the 1990 song by Paul Overstreet, I'm starting to see my Father in me. I notice I walk the way he walks. I notice I talk the way he talks. I'm starting to see my Father in me. So maybe in some ways I'm walking in the steps of my grandfather. Of course, my grandfather on my mother's side was a minister. Obviously, I am following in his footsteps. And every now and then, I have been going through some files. When my grandfather passed away, I inherited a large file with a number of his lessons, sermons that he preached in his life. And here's an example of one of those old outlines. This one goes all the way back to the 1960s. And what is interesting about this one, and I have shared examples of this with you in the past as well, he actually preached this sermon here, September the 12th, 1965. He preached it at Woodson Chapel in 1970, preached it at Shackle Island in 1952, Hendersonville in November of 1956. And in a great example of how times have changed, he preached it at Otter Creek in 1959. And so today I'm going to share with you his lesson titled In His Steps. Our text for the morning comes from 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his steps. And so if we're to follow in the steps of Jesus, my grandfather would want you to know that we must first of all avoid religious insincerity. In Matthew 15, verse 8, the Word of God says, "These people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." Oftentimes we will do things just to be seen. We'll even talk about going to an event just to make an appearance. Well, there's nothing wrong with going to an event just to make an appearance. There's nothing wrong with going to a social occasion to be seen. But when it comes to the Lord's church, there's no room for that type of attitude. In Luke 18, Jesus tells this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, "God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all I possess." And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his chest, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." Jesus went on to say, "I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." We need to avoid religious insincerity, doing what we do to be seen by men. We need to examine ourselves as we take the Lord's Supper, not doing it for appearance sake, not doing it for a ritualistic sake. Because he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the body of Christ. God is spirit, John 4, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Our worship cannot be mere technical manual of steps to check off and then say that we have completed it. Our worship must be truthful. It must also be spiritual. That is to say, it must come from the heart. We worry about sensationalism and showmanship in worship. If the song leader demonstrates too much passion or the minister is too animated, then we believe that our worship has become a farce. Tragically, too often our worship services look more like a funeral service than a worship service. And I have, and easy for me to say, and as I have told you before, I would rather tone down a fanatic than resurrect a corpse. I'm pretty sure I can do the first and pretty confident I can't do the latter. And so we must avoid religious insincerity. We must, if we are going to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, avoid vain worship. In vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. There are some things that I would not have the audacity to do. It's amazing to me the audacious things that people are willing to do. But there are some things that I would not be so audacious as to do. Rebuking Jesus is one example of that. But there were some people audacious enough to do that. Matthew 15, why do your disciples transgress the traditions of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat bread. He answered and said to them, why do you transgress the commandment of God? Because of your tradition. And so here we see an example of people who major in the minors and minor in the majors. This is not the washing of hands that we read about here in Matthew 15. This is not the washing of hands that we are encouraged to do today in light of the COVID-19 situation. This was a symbolic or traditional washing. It had no practical application beyond the tradition of it. And people need to be reminded that vain worship is not pleasing to God. My grandfather would want you to know that if you're going to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, that we must avoid inconsistency. In Matthew 23, verse 2, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do. But do not do according to their works, for they say and do not do. They bind heavy burdens hard to bear and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. And we need to practice what we preach. Now, no one is perfect. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Our lives will never live up to the expectations that might be placed upon us 100% of the time. But the greater the inconsistency in our lives, the less credibility we have. And so it is important that we practice what we preach to the fullest extent that we are able to do that. Our lives need to mirror the message. And so many times, Christians' lives are like carnival mirrors. They don't reflect the truth. They don't reflect the true image. It's distorted. Now, there's no such thing as a flawless diamond. There's no such thing as a flawless mirror. There will always be incongruities. There will always be imperfections. But the emphasis that we need to focus on, or the thing that we need to focus on, is the importance of walking the walk as consistently as we possibly can. It's been said that we would rather see a sermon than hear one. In 1 Timothy 4, verse 12, the Word of God says, let no one despise your youth, but be an example to believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, and in purity. And so Paul is challenging Timothy to not only preach, remember it's the same Paul who told Timothy to preach the word, to be ready in season and out of season, but in addition to talking the talk, Paul tells Timothy to walk the walk. A fourth thing that we must avoid if we are going to walk in the steps of Jesus is self-righteousness. Also, he spoke this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Let's go back to the parable of the two men who went to the temple to pray. You have the Pharisee who is thanking God that he's not like other men, and you have the publican, the tax collector, who simply said, God, be merciful on me, the sinner. And here is a hallmark of Pharisees. Here is a hallmark of hypocrisy. Here's how you can know it. The Pharisee had a bad eye on himself, he had a good eye on his neighbor, and he had no eye whatsoever on God. He was incapable of seeing his own flaws, He was more than capable of seeing someone else's flaws, and he missed the entire point of God entirely. We have lots of faults that we cannot see, but we can see others' faults. I like the story of the individual, the husband and wife, and they were sitting in their living room talking, and they were looking out the front window at the neighbor across the street. And the wife commented to the husband how filthy their windows were, and how she couldn't believe that someone would allow their windows to get so filthy. The husband, without saying a word, gets up, walks to the garage, gets a ladder, goes out front, and proceeds to clean their own window, which was the actual problem. So easy for us to see someone else's faults, real or imagined, and not see our own faults. Oftentimes we will wink at our own trespasses as we condemn the trespasses of others. So we need to avoid self-righteousness. We need to avoid evil thinking. We are what we think. And in Matthew 5, Jesus makes it clear. In terms of legality, there may be a difference, but in terms of spirituality, there is not. Murder and hateful thoughts are the same thing. Adultery and lustful thoughts are the same thing. Jesus makes it clear, you need not commit the act to be guilty of the sin. And so, Paul would tell the Philippians, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate, think on these things. The direction of our day will always go the direction of our mind. Have you heard the term downward spiral? Have you ever gotten into a downward spiral before? You can let one bad thing happen, and then every single thing else that happens in that day just piles on and piles on and piles on. Something that might be extremely trivial can be the catalyst for a horrible day. And the reason is because the direction of our day is going to go the direction of our minds. I'm getting a little better at this. I guess it has to do with age. I would say maturity, but I know I'd get some chuckles for that one. But I'm getting a little bit better at that when I'm involved in an automobile accident. Well, vehicles can be repaired, people cannot. I delivered a rick of wood to my brother-in-law the other day, and he said, let Trig out of the truck, let him run around. Only problem is, my brother-in-law forgot to close the garage door. So here I am chasing Trig all up and down General Bank Drive, and my brother-in-law felt horrible about it. He apologized all over himself, even sent me a text later in the day to apologize again, and my response to that was, it's not a problem. All's well that ends well, to quote Shakespeare. I'm getting a little better at it. I'm not great at it. But if we could stop for a minute, as our day begins to spiral, and do what Paul says, not focus on the negative, not focus on the bad, but focus on the noble, the true, the pure, the lovely things, then our day will not spiral out of control. We need to avoid that negative evil thinking. We need to avoid evil speaking. In 1 Peter 2, verse 1, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and evil speaking. We ought to stop and think. We need to be careful what we speak. James 1:19. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. And I suppose this is the one that I have the biggest trouble with on this list. I've said it many times before, the only thing that's ever gotten me trouble in my life is my mouth. And so we need to be careful when we speak. It has been said that God gives us two ears and one mouth for a reason. We need to be big enough to discuss issues, not men. And our politicians today certainly need to take that cue. We need to be big enough to discuss issues, not men. Too often we condemn the mistakes of fallible men instead of commending the redemptive actions they endeavor to perform. I think of Saul, or Paul. And when Saul had come to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were afraid of him and did not believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared to them how he had seen the Lord on the road and that he had spoken to him and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. So he was with them at Jerusalem, coming in and going out. And so here we've got an individual who has come to Christ in a very dramatic way, Saul on the Damascus Road. I saw this one the other day. You may have seen it as well. It said that they were looking forward to Wilson County being like Saul, that the county would demask us. Well, Saul on the road to Damascus comes into a dramatic conversion experience with the Lord. And when he comes to the church in Jerusalem, they will not associate with him. They were talking negatively about him. They did not believe his conversion. And so, let's be big enough to discuss issues, not men. And then finally, my grandfather would want us to know that in following in the steps of Jesus, we must avoid partial obedience. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! You pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. The scribes and the Pharisees, they left undone the weighties of the law. And we can see today how many people leave things undone that they ought not to leave undone. Christians will take the Lord's Supper, but then rake out scraps to the Lord in offering, service, attendance, and everyday Christian living. Jesus would say, no one putting his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. And so it is full obedience that the Lord expects. Had Naaman only dipped six times in the Jordan River, and he did dip six times, but it wasn't until the seventh that he was healed of his leprosy. Partial obedience is insufficient to get the job done. God is not content with partial obedience. He expects complete, total obedience to His Word. And so this morning, will you walk in the steps of Jesus? Will you follow Him completely, totally, wholly? We'll end where we began, with the words of Peter. For to this you were called, because of Christ's suffering for us, that you should follow in His steps. Jesus was baptized by John. It's not because he was sinful. It's not that he needed to be washed. One of the things I love about Jesus is he's never asked us to do anything that he wasn't willing to do himself. He was an example to us. And so if you've never followed in his steps in that way, then this morning I want to encourage you to take that first step. Repent of sin, confess Jesus as the Christ, and have your sins washed away through baptism. And it might be that as a Christian, you've not been avoiding some of these things that we have been discussing. Then we would be happy to pray with you and pray for you. If you're subject to the Lord's invitation this morning, Jesus invites you, and we stand and sing to encourage you.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the Master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now saved am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Sick, those in special need of our prayers. We pray, Father, for our president. We pray for all those that are sickened by the pandemic. We pray, Father, that this will soon be ended. And once again, we bring back to our normal situations. We just pray, Father, that you be with this country in these perilous times. Don't abandon us, Father. There's a lot of good people in this country. We just pray that you be with us. Keep us safe till we meet again. To Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen.